So let us start our discussion. Today's class will actually complete our discussion on carrier transport, and then I will very briefly review the PN junction diode. Okay, because PN junction diode, especially in reverse bias, is particularly useful because we can use some of the equations directly in context of MOS capacitor. Okay, so carrier transport I was talking about in the previous class. We started discussing about the drift phenomena first, and to understand the drift phenomena, we consider a piece of semiconductor with length L, W width and D thickness. And it was actually driven by a battery with potential V. So an electric field will be established in the semiconductor along the channel length, along the length direction, and therefore carriers will gain energy, and they keep moving in the lattice with an average velocity, average drift velocity VD. Okay, so if we compute the current, we get the following expression. We get the following current expression in terms of surface charge density. I equal to W, I equal to W Q prime, I equal to W, the width of the channel, Q prime, the surface charge density, and the drift velocity VD. Drift velocity VD. So I equal to W Q prime VD is the drift current. This can also be represented in alternate form. Rather than using the drift velocity term VD, this can be expressed in terms of carrier mobility and the electric field. Particularly, if electric field is very small, less than this critical field for the ca for silicon case, then the VD can be written as mu B into E. It's a very straightforward relationship between the drift velocity and electric field. This can be used in the current expression here, and we can get the current expression I in this form, I equal to W by L Q prime, the surface charge density, multiplied by the mobility term and multiplied by the potential difference that was set up between the two faces of the semiconductor material. Okay, so from this drift current expression, we can also find out the sum of the material property. Okay, we can find out the conductance and conductivity. So the current expression I equal to mu B N Q W D divided by L into V. Okay, so I is proportional to V. I equal to G time V. That is the so-called Ohm's law. That is the Ohm's law basically. So we can actually compare this expression one with expression two, and we'll be able to write down the expression for the conductance G. G equal to mu B N Q W D divided by L. So G is the conductance, and conductance is 1 upon resistance, as you know. So the conductance G can be written in terms of conductivity, cross-sectional area, and the length. So G equal to conductance is conductivity cross sectional area divided by length, and from here the conductivity sigma can be expressed as conductivity sigma can be expressed as sigma equal to mu b n into q, and that is 1 upon actually resistivity. Conductivity is 1 upon resistivity. So if I have to find out the resistivity, resistivity is 1 upon mu b n cube. If I have to write down the resistivity in terms of material property. So sheet resistance is a very useful concept. Okay, you'll see how. So let us define the sheet resistance first. Resistance, total resistance, this is not sheet resistance. The total resistance R is equal to 1 upon G. Okay, so the conductance, 1 by conductance is resistance. And 1 by G is basically, if we take the G expression that we have got after comparing the Ohm's law equation with the drip current expression. So 1 upon G is nothing but 1 upon UB, bulk mobility, and Q into the length divided by W into T. And this can be simplified if we could if we could invoke here the terms of surface charge density Q prime. So Q prime was basically, if you recall, n time Q time d. Okay, so n, Q, and d can be clubbed together, and we'll get Q prime, the surface charge density, charge per unit surface area. So the resistance term can be now written as 1 upon mu b into Q prime multiplied by L by W, the length divided by width. This D term has actually absorbed by this Q prime term. Okay, so from here the resistance R equal to R can be written in terms of the sheet resistance in the following fashion. R is the total resistance, which is equal to the sheet resistance multiplied by L by W, the length divided by the width. Okay, and if I compare this, if I considering this equation 1 and this equation 2, then from here I can find out the resistance, sheet resistance equal to 1 upon mu b into Q prime. So if the surface charge density and the mobility, carrier mobility, are known, we can find out the sheet resistance. Okay, and sheet resistance concept is very interesting, because you can see here that if I consider L equal to W, if the length is considered equal to the width of the sample, then basically the resistance turns into the sheet resistance RS. Okay, so if I consider a square, I'm considering a semiconductor, piece of the semiconductor, and the top of let's say that surface is a square, I mean its top view is a square with length L and the width W. Okay, so the resistance of this piece of the semiconductor will be equal to the sheet resistance, R equal to RS. Because if I put L equal to W, then from the sheet resistance turns into sheet resistance. So total resistance then becomes equal to the sheet resistance. Okay, so if sheet resistance is known, then just by looking looking at the dimension of the semiconductor, we can immediately tell what is the total resistance offered by that particular semiconductor sample. You can see one example here, and this is demonstrated the usefulness of the sheet resistance here. What you see that there are two samples, two semiconductor samples. Okay, so here you see that there are length, this is length A1 and the width is B1, and A1 is of course 4 times that of B1. A1 is 4 times that of B1. So the total resistance in this case is going to be 4 times RS, because R equal to RS into L by W. So L is basically A1 is 4 times B1, so R total resistance become 4 times, total resistance now become equal to 4 times RS. Okay, now just look at the another sample. Here again you can see that the dimensions are A2 and B2, and it is not necessary that A2 is equal to A1. Okay, A2 is some other dimension. Okay, A2 is not equal to A1, and similarly B2 is also not equal to B1. But both are made of the same material, so their mobility and let's say the doping level is same, so surface charge density is same for both cases. Only the physical dimensions, length and width, are different. Okay, but this ratio is maintained here. Again, even in this case, A2 is equal to 4 times B2. Okay, although A2 not equal to A1, this A2 length is not equal to A1. And the B2 is not equal to B1, but A2 is 4 times B2 in this case. So since the two materials are made same and their doping levels are same, so surface charge densities are same, electronic mobility are same, if we consider, then again in this case we can say that the total resistance is equal to 4 times RS. Okay, so if the seat, this is usefulness of the seat resistance, if it is known, then you can just see how many squares are seen from the top of the sample, and you will be able to immediately predict the total resistance of the sample. So this is the seat resistance concept, and it's very very useful in context of semiconductor device analysis. Okay, so this is in brief the drift mechanism of the current drift mechanism of the current flow in the semiconductor. So drift mechanism, carriers are basically gain energy from the external electric field, and they move in the crystal in a directed manner, and when carrier movement is there, then there will be current. So that is the drift current. Now come to the another phenomena of the current flow in the semiconductor, which is diffusion. Okay, so diffusion, to understand the diffusion, again a piece of semiconductor is considered here, and with the similar dimension, length, width and the thickness, and unlike the previous case, this is not uniformly doped. Okay, so this concentration gradient is there in the in this semiconductor, and that concentration gradient is along the channel length. Okay, so the region may be this was not uniformly doped, or it could be because of some sort of equilibrium, by some mechanism the carriers are injected from this side of the semiconductor. So if extra carriers are injected from this kind of semiconductor, they will also again diffuse inside, and because of that there could be a non-uniform charge distribution. So in this case you see that the charge distribution is something like this. It's varying linearly slowly along the x direction. At this point, if this is let's say x equal to 0, so at x equal to 0 the charge density is maximum, and when you are moving along the channel length, it keeps decreasing slowly. Okay, so basically this diffusion current has nothing to do with the polarity of the carriers. Okay, even you see that if there is a diffusion in gas molecules which are neutral, they will diffuse from higher concentration side to the lower concentration side. So similarly here, the electrons concentration, electron density is higher towards the left end of the semiconductor and lower towards the right end. So carrier will tend to diffuse from left to right, and as a result you will see there could be a current. Okay, so if the current direction is reference current direction is from right to left, if this is the current reference current direction, so the total current can be written as the total current I is going to be proportional to W into D. W is the width, D thickness. So this is cross section area. Okay. So the of course larger the cross section area, larger diffusion will happen. So I is proportional to W by D. I will of course proportional to the electronic charge, and I is also proportional to the gradient of the electronic charge density. Okay. So nx dnx upon dx, we are considering that the carrier concentration gradient is only along the channel length, so that's why this is dnx upon dx. Okay, and the minus sign is put here because to match the reference direction of the current. Okay, so because this is negative, dnx by dx is negative. Okay, left side higher density, right side lower density. So dnx by dx is itself negative. So negative negative, this becomes positive, so that the total current is in direction of the reference direction, in our reference. So this is our reference direction. Okay, so I here, the total current is now all these proportional proportionality can be clubbed together, and we get I equal to Q WD multiplied by minus DNX upon DX, and the D is the proportionality constant, which is called diffusivity or diffusion constant. Okay, and the diffusion constant is as you know by the Einstein relationship, D is proportional to mu B. D is equal to mu b. Diffusivity can be related with the mobility, so D is mu b into phi t. D by mu is phi t, a constant. Okay, similar relation can also be written for whole. So D upon mu n equal to phi t, D upon mu b equal to phi t. So this is so-called Einstein relationship. So this relation can be invoked here, and also we can also use at the same time QB prime, the surface charge density equal to minus QDNX. So combining all these, we'll be able to write here the drift current equation as a diffusion current expression as I equal to W mu B phi T D phi X by TX. Okay. So this is another type of the current that can flow in the semiconductor. This could be because of the electrons or because of the holes. I have written here a general relation depending upon the concentration gradients of electron and hole. We could write down the expression, drift diffusion current expression for the electrons and holes. Okay, so here we have discussed the two different component of the currents, the drift current and the diffusion current. These two currents will be particularly, these two current expression will be particularly useful for our further analysis of the MOS transistor, where we will derive the current expressions of MOS transistor considering the drift and diffusion phenomena happening in the channel of the MOS transistor. Okay, so you need to bear these two equations in your mind, because we'll be directly using this expression whenever we'll be referring to either drift equations or the diffusion equation. Okay, so any question, doubt so far from anybody? Am I audible to all of you? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, any question, doubt? Okay, these are basic steps, so I think you are comfortable with this. Okay, the only unique thing is the way the expressions, the equations are expressed here, because we'll be using these equations directly later on. So now you are familiar with these equations. Now very quickly, I will review the p-n junction today, and with this analysis, with the review of the p-n junction, we'll complete our introduction part of this course. Okay. So p-n junction in context of contact potential has already been discussed in the previous class, and you recall that we derived the expression of the contact potential, or the so-called built-in potential in this case, and it was simply this phi bi equal to phi fp minus phi fn, and phi fp expression is basically kt phi t natural log of na upon ni, and phi fn is again phi t natural log of nd upon ni. So substituting these two in this expression, we'll be able to find out the contact potential phi bi, which is equal to kt by q, or kt by q is nothing but phi t. It's phi t, so it is phi t natural log of na and d upon ni square. Okay, so when the semiconductor, the p-n junction is in equilibrium, when no external energy source is connected between the terminals anode and cathode, then basically there will be a depletion region formed, and across the depletion region a potential difference is observed, which is called the contact potential. The built-in we can also call it the built-in potential. Okay, and of course this potential, built-in potential, if the both side of the p-n junction has comparable doping level, then you will see that the potential drop will be seen both side of the junction. Some potential will be dropped here, so another potential will be dropped here. So sum of these two is the built-in potential phi bi. Okay, I have already explained this energy band diagram. Okay, because the semiconductor is in equilibrium after a certain time. Okay, so the Fermi level is perfectly aligned from N side to P side, so you can see that this Fermi level is aligned. So EFN, the electronic Fermi level of N side is equal to EFP, the Fermi level of the P side. Both are perfectly aligned, and just to align this, you have to see there should be a band bending because of the presence of this electric field at the junction, and the band bending is basically reflecting the presence of electric field and the potential drop phi bi. So the amount of bending can be the built-in potential is nothing but can be related with the amount of bending in the conduction band and valence band. Okay, so EI has to be in the middle of this forbidden gap, so this will follow EC and EV, and also the reference level which I plotted earlier as a ER, that will also follow this banding, because you see that electron affinity is the material property, so electron affinity has to be same here and here and here everywhere. So for this region, you will see that the reference level has to also bend along with this EC and EV. So thus we get this kind of energy band diagram of the PN junction when no externally applied bias is connected. We can call the junction is in equilibrium as the two Fermi levels are perfectly aligned and no current is flowing in the steady state. Okay, so this can be very easily explained with the junction concept, contact potential concept that we have discussed in the previous class. Okay, and now take a special case of the forward bias. Okay, so in forward bias, you know that positive potential external source is connected between the anode and cathode. So here you see, look at the polarity of this potential. The P side is now is connected to the positive terminal of the battery. N side is connected with the negative terminal of the battery. Okay, so if the battery potential is capital V, and this is not very high. Okay, this potential should be a low potential value in the order of you can say the built-in potential, not very much larger than the built-in potential. For that case only we are doing this analysis. So if the built-in the contact potential is already there, you can see that is psi 1 plus psi 2, which was potential difference seen at the junction because of the work function difference. Okay, and now this external potential V is connected, and considering that this neutral region has a very good conductivity, and this N region has also very good conductivity, lot of holes are here, electrons are here. So resistance of this neutral P region is very very small, as well as the resistance of this N region is also very small. So no potential drop in this N region and P region, and the contact potential will be neutralizing to each other. So this potential, external potential V, is going to appear across this depletion region, because the depletion region here resistivity is less. So if the resistivity is less, then we can consider that this entire potential drop will occur at this junction. So just look at the polarity of this. This capital V, this is going to be appear like this, plus V here and minus V here. Okay, so between across the junction, it is going to appear with this particular polarity. And if it is so, then the total potential across the junction, which is represented as psi here, psi is the contact potential phi vi minus v. Because if you recall the polarity of the contact potential, then the N side was at the higher potential than the P side. But for this external potential, the P side is at higher potential than the N side. So if we are considering that the contact potential psi has the overall potential is has same polarity of the contact potential psi, then contact potential phi vi, then this overall potential across this junction is turns out to be phi vi minus v. Okay, so the now the contact potential is equal to the built-in potential vvi minus v. So this potential is smaller than that of the built-in potential, because this term is subtracted from this, and therefore the equilibrium, so-called equilibrium, is broken here. Because I said earlier that when the two materials are at the different energy level, Fermi level, so carriers will start moving from one side to N side. So let us talk about electron first. So when the electrons are moving from this side, then this side becomes positive, this side becomes negative, electric field will be established, and this electric field will now restrict the movement of the carrier from left to right. So an equilibrium is set up. Now this electric field is weakened by this externally applied potential V. So once it is weakened, then this equilibrium is broken, and now the carriers will start moving from one side to another side. So electron from N side to P side and hole from P side to N side. So you'll see that a lot of carrier movement will start happening through the device, and therefore there will be current. Okay, so equilibrium is broken now because of this externally applied potential V, and in this case you will see that the two Fermi levels, Fermi energy level of P side and Fermi energy level of N sides are not aligned. Okay, because if there is a gradient, that is indication of a current. If the Fermi level is constant, and then if you take the derivative of this with respect to S, if it becomes constant, means zero current. Okay, so now the Fermi levels has to will not be aligned, and the splitting of the Fermi level is also inevitable here. Now, because you see that when the forward bias is applied, then what happens? From P side to N side, holes will be injected, and from N side to P side, the electrons will be injected. Okay, so as a result, you will see that there will be excess carrier, excess electrons at this depletion edge and P side interface, and there will be excess hole at this depletion edge and N side. Okay, so there will be excess hole here and excess electrons here. So you see that when the equilibrium is broken, when there are excess carriers are introduced, then a single Fermi level cannot be used to compute both electronic and hole concentration. So the quasi Fermi levels need to be defined. Okay, so let's say that the quasi Fermi level for hole is EFP, and for the electron is EFN. Okay, so this is P side, and from when I move from here bottom to top of this structure, basically this is equivalent to here movement of right to left. Okay, so the two sides Fermi level, the electronic Fermi level of N side is going to be differ from the electronic Fermi level of P side. Okay, that is sure. And this splitting of the Fermi level is because of this presence of electric field. So the Fermi level difference between the N side and P side is the magnitude. If you look at the energy gap difference between these two, this must be going to be Q times V. Okay, but we have to identify which side Fermi level will be higher than this. At the higher level, and which side Fermi level is at which side it will be at the lower level. So just check the polarity here. You can see that the negative side of the battery is connected to N side. So the N side is at negative potential compared to the P side. And therefore, the energy is basically, you know, that minus Q times V. So negative potential multiplied by this minus QV electronic energy, it becomes QV. So the energy of N side goes higher than the energy of the P side. And therefore, you will see that here EFN is splitted by EFP by this magnitude Q times V. So this gap Q times V, which is basically the split in the Fermi levels, quasi electronic quasi Fermi level here and the whole Fermi level here, and the energy of N side goes higher because of this negative, because the N side is connected with the negative edge of the battery. So the positioning of these different Fermi levels can be explained in this particular manner, in this particular manner. Okay, so now this is clear. This gap is going to be QV, and in neutral region here, let's say that it is Fermi level EFP. So in neutral region, if I have to compute the electron and hole concentration, both could be done, both could be can be computed with the CFP level, but in depletion region, basically, you see that the splitting of the Fermi level is happening here. Okay, So in this particular fashion, so this change is basically a slow change is observed. Okay, as I said that there cannot be a sudden change in the Fermi level like this. If there is a this kind of change in the Fermi level, then basically this will lead to infinite current, because in very small if for a very small position change delta x, if there is a change in the energy, del ef by del x is going to be very large, and the current is going to be very very large. So that is not a practical case. So this is because you see that the splitting of the Fermi level is happening slowly, it's happening gradually. Okay, and then it reaches to this level, EFN level. And similarly here for EFN, the ear splitting is happening, and then it goes to the EFP level here. Okay, so please note that even in depletion region, although we are considering that there are depletion region is free from the carrier, only fixed charges, acceptor and the donor and the acceptor ions are there, but that is not true. Even there will be some electrons, but in the less concentration. Otherwise, it would be hard to explain how the current will flow. So electronic and the whole concentrations are there in even in the depletion region, but their concentration is much less than the concentration of electrons and hole in neutral and NP region respectively. Okay, so this is basically the energy band diagram in the forward bias case. Okay, and the total bending in this case is now less than that of the equilibrium case, because now you see that this externally applied potential V is going to oppose the built-in potential phi b. So the total bending here is only phi bi, the built-in potential, minus capital V, unlike the case of equilibrium when it was equal to phi bi in case of equilibrium. Okay. So lower energy barrier means more carrier movement from N side to P side and P side to N side. So there will be significant current, and the current can be written can be represented by this expression, I equal to I naught e to the power V, which is the applied potential, by phi t minus 1 under forward bias case. Okay. Is it clear to all of you? Any question, any doubt? Shall I go ahead? Anybody, any question? Okay, now let us talk about the reverse bias case. So this is more going to be, we'll spend little bit more time for the reverse bias, because the equations that are derived here can be directly used for the MOS capacitor case. So in reverse bias, you can see that again a battery is connected, but the battery polarity is reversed. Now you see that the N side is connected to the positive terminal of the battery, and the P side is connected with the negative terminal of the battery. Okay, and now this capital V is going to appear across this depletion region in same phase, in the similar direction as the contact potential. So now the total potential psi, the total contact potential psi is going to be equal to phi bi plus capital V, because now this is as a positive B, and this is, so you see that this is negative, and the contact, for contact potential also, the built-in potential also here, built-in potential is positive this side and negative this side. So both get added to find out the total contact potential. If I represent this by psi c, then psi c in this case is phi vi plus v. So now to accommodate this, you can see the larger potential difference, the width of the depletion region now gets wider. It will get wider both side, towards n side and p side. Getting wider means more donor ions will be uncovered towards the n side, and more acceptor ions will be uncovered towards p side. Okay, so let's say that the depth of the depletion region d1 towards n side and d2 towards p side. Okay, then the total charge q1 charge, donor charge, if because of these positive fixed ions here, is equal to plus q d1a into nd, because nd, let's say, is the donor charge density and a is the cross section area of this diode. So this is basically the capital A cross section area, and d1 is this length, depth of the depletion towards the n side. So the total electronic charge, the total charge because of the donor ions, which is actually positive charge, is equal to q time d1a into nd. And the total charge towards the p side because of the acceptor ions are equal to minus q d2a into Na, because of the same region. Na is now the acceptor charge density, acceptor ion density, number of acceptor density, you can say, number of acceptor ions per unit volume. Okay, and to maintain the charge neutrality, as you know, it should be in this case. So the total positive charge must be equal to the total negative charge. Okay. The total positive charge, the two charges can be equated, and when the two charges are equated, then we can get a relation between the depth of penetration of the depletion region towards the n side and p side. And you can see here that we can get this d1 by d2 equal to Na upon Nd just by dividing 1 by 2. We can get this relationship. Okay, just by comparing q1 to equal to q2, we can get d1 by d2 equal to Na upon Nd. Okay, and the charge here, charge profile is shown. So the charge profile, you can see, to n side we'll have fixed donor ions here in the depletion region, and the donors are basically, they are positive ions. So the charge density here, donor charge density, is shown as qnd, and the acceptor charge density here is shown as minus qna, because the acceptor ions are negative ions and their charge density is na. So total charge density minus qna plus qnd here. So in this is neutral region, so charge density is zero in this region, and again this is neutral region, so charge density is zero in this case, in this particular region. So this is our qnd, and this is minus qna. Okay, so from this charge distribution we can find out this electric field, because if you recall the Gauss law expression, so Gauss law expression suggests that the electric field EY is basically can be obtained by integrating this charge density with respect to a dummy variable dy. And since the charge density is constant in this region, then the electric field has to increase in this particular fashion, okay, in the linear fashion. So that's why we got this shape of the electric field here. And then you see that at this junction, this is the junction, PN junction. So at the junction, the charges changes the polarity from the positive charge to the negative charge. So therefore, you see that the field direction of the field will change, and the field now goes to zero at the edge of this depletion region. The edge of the depletion region, the electric field is zero, and at the junction, the electric field is at its peak level. So that is very obvious, because you see that here the electric field lines will emerge from the positive charges, and that will terminate to the negative charges. Okay, so field lines, all the field lines will actually pass through this junction, because one side is positively charged, another side is negatively charged. So definitely the electric field peak will be seen at this junction. That can also be discussed qualitatively in this particular fashion. Okay, so the electric field peak can be determined. The electric field peak is the peak of this electric field. This is if electric field variation, so electric field peak is this. Okay, so electric field peak is nothing but the charge confined in this region divided by epsilon s, or charge confined in this region divided by epsilon s, just by if we just look at the magnitude of the electric field. Okay, so qnd d1 is the total charge confined in this region, and that is multiplied by epsilon s. So this is the peak of the electric field, or this can also be obtained by multiplying the total charge in this and then divided it by epsilon s. But please note that by this method we can only get the peak of the electric field. If you'd like to find out how the electric field is varying along the x direction, then you will see that you'll have to integrate, you have to solve this equation, and then you can use the boundary conditions that zero electric field at this point and this point, and same electric field matches at this sign, and then you you can solve these equations to get the expression for the electric field variation along the position. So I'm not going into that, because that is not the interest our in. That is not actually relevant here. Just I am going to consider the finding here that the peak is equal to the total charge in this box divided by epsilon s as per the Gauss law. Okay, and now the two potentials are under the two triangles. So the potential, as I said, that here there will be potential drop. That is psi 1 here and psi 2 here. Okay, so psi 1 plus psi 2 together makes the VBI, the built-in potential. Okay, so so the two potentials are basically psi 1 and psi 2 are nothing but the area under this electric field curve, because if you E is d, E electric field is minus d psi by dx, you can say. So psi is the integration of E electric field. Okay, so it means that if we electric integration means we can take or either we have to integrate this curve. We have to get the electric field expression and then integrate that, and then you'll get how the surface potential is varying with respect to x. This is one way of doing. But if we just only want to jump onto the conclusion on the magnitude of this potential, then what we can do, we can just take the area of this curve, because this is just in a triangle, and we know from the property of the triangle we can directly compute this area. That must be equal to the potential drop here psi 1, and similarly we can also compute the area of this triangle, and that is going to be the area of that is this potential drop psi 2. So psi 1 and psi 2 can be computed directly by computing the two areas, and therefore here you can see that psi 1 is the potential psi 1 is, this is basically the E peak. The electric field here is this is E peak. Okay, so E peak multiplied by this d1 multiplied by half is this area. So that is basically psi 1, and similarly for psi 2 you can write down the expression. So here you see that the two potentials psi 1 and psi 2 are expressed Okay, psi 1 and psi 2 are expressed. You can see E peak d1 by 2. E peak expression is already known, that is q d1 d1 q n d d1. So q n d d1 square upon 2 epsilon s is psi 1, and similarly psi 2 is q n a d2 square upon 2 epsilon. So these are the two potentials, psi 1 plus psi 2. By adding these two, we can get the total built-in potential VBI. Okay, built-in potential. All right. So one thing actually I forgot, I didn't explain this energy bind diagram. So we can also discuss this. You can take analogy from what we have discussed for the forward bias case. So you can see that again the equilibrium is broken because of this external electric field, and because of the external electric field, because of this external source of the energy. And you can see that now the N side is positive side respect to the P side because of this battery. So the energy of N side is now will be less than that of the energy of the P side. So now the Fermi level will be, Fermi levels will be splitted up with the separation Q time V. You can see that this is in terms of energy, this is Q time V. So for the N side, the N Fermi level EFN, for P side it is EFP, and the difference between the two is capital V, which is connected here. Okay, and now the N side is N side Fermi level EFN goes below EFP. In the previous case EFN went up with respect to EFP. Okay, so this is because of the polarity of the external bias here. And now you can see that since the bending is in this particular manner, it is a reflection that now the more band bending, larger band bending compared to the forward bias case, so means that there is a larger potential drop and the wider the depletion region. Okay, so this was a two-sided junction, however, but in a practice because we are discussing this to make our to lay the background of our further discussion. So there we'll be discussing about the MOS capacitor. So rather than having a NP junction, if we talk about N plus P junction, it will be more appropriate, and this could be more useful for our further analysis. So N plus P means the N side is now having higher doping than the P side. Okay, N side is considerably larger doped. You see that in an ordinary, generally PN junction diode, P side is having higher doping than N side. But here we are taking a hypothetical situation because we want to later on like to draw the analogy from our discussion with this discussion. So that's why we are considering here N plus P. So with N plus P, since N side is very heavily doped compared to the P side, so the depletion region encroachment towards the N side will be very small compared to that of the P side. And what we can do, we can just neglect the depletion region into N side, and we can consider that the depletion region is present only in P side. So one-sided depletion region can be considered in N plus P junction. So what we can consider, that D1 is 0, only D2 is equal to the total depletion width, and at the same time we can also say that the total the built-in potential is only because of psi 2, because we are considering that psi 1 is 0. Okay, so under this assumption, under the assumption of one-sided PN junction, we can when the ND is much greater than NA, because this is the reflection of N plus P. So D1 much less than D2, phi 1 is the potential towards N side, towards P, less than towards P side, then the total contact potential is going to be equal to only phi 2. So for N plus P junction, the phi 2, the total contact potential is equal to q na d2 square upon 2 epsilon s. Okay, the two potentials were derived here. Okay, the two potentials were derived as psi 1 plus psi 2. We are considering psi 1 equal to 0, So only psi 2 is going to define the contact potential. So psi 2 equal to psi c. Psi c equal to psi c is the total contact potential drop. Okay, psi c equal to q n a d 2 square upon 2 epsilon s. So that is actually substituted here. Psi c equal to psi c equal to q n a d 2 square upon 2 epsilon. So from this expression, we can get the depth of the depletion region towards p side, which is equal to 2 epsilon s q n a into square root of psi c. Okay, and now since d 2 is known, so we can find out the charge per unit area in the p side. The charge per unit area is basically the total charge divided by the area. So total charge towards the p side. So let me draw here the picture. Okay, this was n side and p side is now the total depletion region. Okay, so here the doping density is Na. So the acceptor ion density, the acceptor ion charge is basically q time Na. So q time Na, and this is the d2, the depth of the depletion region. And the area of this device is, let's say, capital A. Okay, so minus q time d2 a into Na is the total charge divided by the area capital A. So in this case, the qt prime now becomes, since we can substitute the expression of d2, d2 has already been derived. So if d2 is substituted from the previous expression here, then the total charge per unit area turns out to be minus q 2 epsilon s q n a into root psi s into n a, and q2 prime therefore, because this n a this q will be cancelled by this q, and here it will be square root of q, and Na will be cancelled out by this Na, and remaining is a square root of Na. So here we are going to see q2 prime, the total charge charge per unit area in p side is equal to minus 2q epsilon s Na into square root of psi c, where psi c is the contact potential. 2q epsilon s is a constant, of course. Q is electronic charge, epsilon s is the Silicon permittivity. So by substituting the value of q and epsilon s, we can get here. This turns out to be 5.8 into 10 to the power minus 16 coulomb volt to the power minus 1 by 2 centimeter square, centimeter to the power minus 1 by 2 per silicon. Okay. And in reverse bias, the current turns out to be I equal to I naught e to the power I equal to E naught b to the power 5t minus 1. So now since v is negative, then e to the power minus v by vt, this becomes very very small, and what we are left with, we are left with I equal to minus I naught. Okay, I equal to minus I naught in the reverse bias. That's why you see that here the current is almost constant in this region, because this is reverse bias. Beyond this, we'll have breakdown. So again, the current will increase in the breakdown region. So this portion, the current is exponential. In this portion, the current is almost constant. And then in this portion, again, current will be increasing rapidly with the applied potential. Okay. So here I have reviewed the PN junction under the forward case, reverse case, and on the equilibrium case. Okay, one important aspect is still missing, that is the junction capacitance, but I think it will be more appropriate to discuss when we'll be talking about the capacitance of a MOS capacitor. So there actually I will introduce that topic. Okay, so with this we can finish the introduction part of this course, and from next class I will start discussing about the two terminal MOS capacitor. We'll discuss about the modeling of the different parameters, and Then we'll discuss about the capacitance model for the MOS gap, and then finally we'll switch to the another topic. Okay, so if you have any doubt, question so far, based on today's lecture or based on the lecture so far, then you must ask here, because this is the appropriate time. We'll close this, and there will be a small quiz in next class. So that will be based on our discussion so far. I will let you know about the modality, how actually that will be conducted. But you just revise the basic concepts that we have discussed so far. Okay. And if you study them properly, you will be more comfortable in the coming classes. Okay. So please feel free to ask if you have any question. Anybody?
हेलो
हेलो
कैन आई ऑडिबल
हाँ यार यू आर
ऑडिबल कैन यू प्लीज प्रोवाइड अस द कंटेंट ऑफ प्रीवियस क्लासेस यू टोल्ड अस दैट यू विल अपलोड द वीडियोस ऑन यूट्यूब
ओके आई विल डू दैट आई विल अपलोड टुडेज क्लास फर्स्ट बिकॉज़ आई डोंट हैव दैट वीडियो One student is recording, Amiya is recording, so once he will provide all those video, I can upload to the YouTube. And of course, two videos have already been uploaded to my YouTube channel. So you can actually refer to my YouTube channel and you can get the lectures from there. I will share the link of that channel in the WhatsApp group. Okay. Two lectures I have already uploaded, and I will also upload the rest of the lectures. Okay, link
okay,
of
thank you,
that YouTube channel that today I must share that today. Okay.
Sir, can you provide us the PDF also?
PDF for this lecture?
Yeah, the PDF of this and previous lectures too.
Okay, definitely I will do that. I think that I have already given you the PDF of the previous lectures. Okay, but today's lecture I will again share. Okay.
I have only one PDF.
Okay, I will check it. Okay. I will check it and I will share that with you. No problem.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Anybody? Any technical question? Okay, so I don't think that you have any question. Okay, so I will share the material, and now I am going to sign off. Thank you very much for listening. Okay, we'll meet tomorrow again. Thank you.